Now, we just wrapped a series called Sink or Swim, where we looked at these two water-centric miracles that Jesus does in Matthew chapter 8. First, he calms the waves. They're on the lake. The disciples are in the boat with Jesus, and all of a sudden, this giant storm comes. These waves are swamping the boat, and Jesus is asleep, and the disciples sort of panic. They freak out. They wake Jesus up, like, we're dying here. And Jesus gets up. He scolds the waves like they're disobedient children. Like, not you kids, knock it off. The waves go flat, and all is well. And so it's this incredible miracle. It shows us that we have nothing to fear so long as Jesus is in the boat with us. That the God who is with us, the very beginning of Matthew, they'll call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. Very end of Matthew is, surely I am with you until the very end of the age. And so Matthew is showing us over the course of this whole book that Jesus is with us. And as long as he is, we have nothing to worry about because he's in control. Then they finally get across to the other side and they run into this Gentile territory where there are two men who are demon-possessed. And Jesus casts the demons out of them, and with nothing more than one word, by the way, he just says, go. Everybody else back then is doing elaborate rituals. Jesus just says, go. Demons go. They go into these pigs. They drown the pigs in the water. And that causes the town to beg Jesus to leave. Like, you got to go. We can't have this. Why? Because he's just basically, he's sinking their economy while he's sinking these pigs. Like, the pigs are how these guys made their living, and Jesus is killing them. They choose the pigs over people. And all throughout history and still today, you will find people that will choose the pigs over the people. Now, this week, we're going to start a little three-part series where we see what happens when Jesus comes back across the lake. They ask Jesus to go, and Jesus goes, all right, I'm gone. And he leaves. Well, then what happens? Well, that's what we're going to talk about. It's called the wave maker because we're leaving the water behind, but Jesus is still making some waves here, so to speak. See, the next three passages, they're all tied together by controversy. They all show Jesus causing a little bit of a ruckus. Now, it's not that he's necessarily doing things that are overly antagonistic. Like, he's not goading people into debate. He's not being aggressive. You see that in John's gospel a lot. Remember going through that in a Bible quiz in high school as we were going through John's gospel, and like you see Jesus just berating the Pharisees constantly. And that's not what you get here in Matthew. What he's doing is he's living this new example of what the kingdom of God looks like, and that's ruffling people's feathers. He's not aiming to upset people, but he's trying to show them what the kingdom of God looks like. That's upsetting them. It reminded me of the Babylon Bee, the satirical website that I've talked about a few times before. They ran a thing this week that cracked me up. A man unsure if he's persecuted because he's a Christian or because he's a massive jerk. and with Jesus here, he's not doing anything that's outwardly trying to get at people. He's just expressing this is what the kingdom of God's like, and people are taking umbrage with that. The things that Jesus does here, it's going to butt heads with their idols, with their traditions, and that's going to bring forth controversy. Of course, we would never act that way about anything, of course. Now, all three of these controversies have freedom at their core, these things that Jesus is saying, I have the freedom to do. One commentator gives a nice string of F words for this trio, forgiveness, fellowship, and fasting. What'd you think of it? And so this morning is the forgiveness controversy. We'll take a look at what Matthew writes here, Matthew chapter 9, verse 1. Nope. Oh, there we go. Too far. And getting into a boat, he crossed over and came to his own city. And behold, some people brought to him a paralytic lying on a bed. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, take heart, my son, your sins are forgiven. And behold, some of the scribes said to themselves, this man is blaspheming. But Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, why do you think evil in your hearts? For which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he then said to the paralytic, rise, pick up your bed, and go home. And he rose and went home. And when the crowd saw it, they were afraid, and they glorified God who had given such authority to men. Now, this is a story that gets recorded in all three of the Gospels in the New Testament that look kind of the same. There's Matthew, Mark, and Luke that all kind of have a similar feel. They're called the Synoptic Gospels. Syn meaning same, optic meaning look. They look the same. They sort of go about their process in the same way. And so the three of them use similar resources. They use similar references as they were putting their Gospels together. John goes off, does his own thing. But Matthew, Mark, and Luke all kind of have a similar process. And so sometimes we'll see they include the same stories, and then you can kind of see the different perspectives and points of view that they put on those stories. And ironically, even though Matthew is the longest of those three books, when all three of them have a story, Matthew usually has the shortest account of it. Ironically, even though Mark is the shortest of those three books, whenever they have a story in common, Mark is usually the longest of those three. For Matthew, his chief concern is almost always, what is Jesus doing in this story? He is very Jesus-centric. It is all about what Jesus is doing. And he gives you the information about other people only insofar as it informs what Jesus is doing and why. He doesn't pay a lot of attention to anybody else. The focus is always on Jesus. That's one of the reasons why I picked Matthew to be the book that we'd be traveling through here. Now, if you've been in church for a while, you've probably heard this story, but you've probably heard it from one of the other Gospels, most likely Mark, because that's got the most interesting version of what the friends do in this situation. This is the story of the friends who bring their paralyzed friend on a mat to meet Jesus, but Jesus is in a house teaching, and the house is completely packed. There's no way to get into the house. So they do what everybody would do here. They carry him up to the roof on this mat, and then they start digging through the roof, and they open up a hole big enough for this guy, and then they lower him down through the roof to Jesus. So Jesus is standing there, and he's teaching, and all, you can just see like particles of dirt are falling. What's going on? All of a sudden, there's a man-shaped hole, and the guy's lowering down from it. They're looking at like, what is going on? Matthew summarizes all of that with, some people brought to him a paralytic lying on a bed, and when Jesus saw their faith, like, talk about an understatement, right? That right there sums up that whole thing. But for Matthew, the focus is on Jesus. What does Jesus do in this situation? So what did Jesus do? Well, first, he tells this guy, take heart, have courage, don't fear. There's got to be a little bit of trepidation on his part and on his friend's part. I mean, but they're just so desperate to get this guy to Jesus. They're so desperate, in fact, they're willing to wreck somebody's roof to make it happen. Now, naturally, they're probably a little nervous about this whole ordeal, but they came here to bring him to Jesus, and they're going to bring him to Jesus. Maybe this guy on the mat's not super excited about this plan, right? What's he going to do? He's paralyzed on a bed. He can't stop him. Like, guys, we don't have to. Nope, we're doing it. Someone gets this idea. Before you know it, they're on the roof. They're doing minor demolition, and all of a sudden, they're lowering him down. This guy's probably so embarrassed. But Jesus sees him. First thing he says is, courage. Take heart. Don't worry. Don't fear. Chin up. It's okay. Jesus wants us to approach him so confidently. He wants us to come to him boldly, so boldly that nothing's going to stop us. If we've got to tear somebody's roof off, we're going to get to him. It doesn't matter what anybody else thinks. We've got to get to Jesus. That's what Jesus sees here, and that's what he praises and rewards. We can run to him. We can run to him without fear. Now, the next thing is that Jesus tells him that his sins are forgiven. And that means right then and there. This isn't, oh, someday your sins are going to be forgiven, or God has forgiven your sin and I'm just informing you of this. The way Jesus says it here is, I'm forgiving your sin right now. Your sin is forgiven. Everybody in the crowd's got to be wondering, like, well, how does he know? We know Jesus to be the Son of God, but we're seeing this in process for the folks in the stories here, and they're learning this little bit by little bit in moments just like these. They already know about the healing, but now he's proclaiming sins forgiven. And what we see here is we see the gospel at work in a very pure way. Because it's not this man's obedience that causes his sins to be forgiven. It's not Jesus saw how righteous he was and then said, your sins are forgiven. So Jesus saw his faith. It's not the man's righteousness. It's not his friend's righteousness. It's not their obedience. It's not anything they've accomplished. It's nothing but their faith that Jesus rewards and says, your sins are forgiven. Obedience comes after, but it's a response to forgiveness. It's never the cause. And so the scribes hear this and they start thinking. That phrase said to themselves means each one is like thinking it to themselves. They're saying it to them. It's not they're talking amongst each other. They're saying it to themselves individually. And they're going, this is blasphemy. Like, did you hear what he just said? Because they understand no one can forgive sins but God. And if Jesus is forgiving sins here, then he's making this claim that he is divine. Now, true blasphemy charges back then could only be brought if the person used the name of God, which Jesus doesn't do. So they can't come right out and accuse him. So they're all thinking it, but they can't say it. And it's no small accusation to bring, right? Because blasphemy carried the penalty of stoning. You would be executed for this. So they can't come right out and say it because they can't convict him of it. But they're all sitting there and they're all thinking it, like, do you hear that? He's blaspheming. He's equating himself with God. He's not coming right out and saying it, but I know this is what's happening. And so what Jesus is doing, from his perspective, he's just operating under the authority that he normally operates under. And it's just now that everybody else is starting to catch on to what that means. What's interesting is it says that Jesus knows what they were thinking. And so we always kind of wonder, like, we know Jesus was fully God, fully man. Well, what does that mean precisely? Well, we see one of the things it means is that he's able to read their thoughts. He knows exactly what they're thinking. He knows things that they couldn't possibly know. In John's gospel, we get another glimpse of this where he goes to the woman at the well. And he starts telling her her life story. Oh, well, you've had this many husbands and you've got this many kids and the man you're with now is not your husband and so on. And she goes back. She's like, this guy told me my whole life story. Like, how could he possibly know this? And so here, Jesus does sort of a similar thing. He knows their thoughts, even when they're just thinking them, when they haven't actually said them. What we see here, too, is that the scribes here, they're the first Jews to oppose Jesus. Last week, we saw the Gentiles that were like, dude, you got to go. And Jesus, all right, I'm gone. They beg him to leave because he drowns the pigs, or the demons drown the pigs, and they blame him for it. This is the first time amongst the Jews that Jesus is seeing some opposition. They went along with it. He's teaching. He's doing the miracles. Yeah, cool, cool. But they're viewing him as another teacher, a new rabbi, so on. Now, Jesus has crossed the line. I think that's a pretty common response to Jesus even now. So people are cool with him as teacher. They're cool with him as a good example, someone to admire. Oh, he was this great moral teacher. Yeah, but Jesus doesn't let you stop there. He doesn't claim to be that. He claims to be God. His number one priority is forgiveness of sins. That's what he's coming to do. This is where C.S. Lewis wrote this distinction, the liar, lunatic, and Lord. So Jesus claims to be able to forgive sins, to have existed forever, and to be coming back to judge the world at the end of time. He's clearly claiming to be God. So only one of these three things can be true about him. One, he knew that he wasn't actually God, but he conned people into thinking he was. And he was a liar. He was a con man. Second, he thought he was God, but he actually wasn't, in which case he's a crazy person. He's a lunatic. Or, third, he actually is God. It's completely irrational to think, oh, Jesus is a good moral teacher, but he's not divine. Like, no, if he's not divine, this is a guy walking around claiming to be God. He's crazy if he's not. And so in claiming to be God, he's finally crossed the line for these scribes. And now, Jesus has told this paralyzed man, your sins are forgiven. But when the scribes question this, what's he do? Well, he heals him to prove that it's true. He asks the question sort of, well, what's easier? Which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven or get up and walk? Now, of course, it's easier to say your sins are forgiven. Why? Because there's no proof of that. There's no external proof that, oh, your sins are forgiven. Anybody can say that, because how can you measure it? But saying be healed, that's a whole lot more difficult, especially to somebody who's paralyzed. Like if the guy just had like insomnia or migraines or something and be like, be healed, and no one can really check his work on that, right? But this guy's paralyzed. You tell a paralyzed person, be healed, that paralyzed person has to get up and start walking. What's interesting though, is because he asks like, well, which is easier to say? But if you think about what's easier to do, it's actually the opposite, right? Because think about it, like divine healing may be difficult, but healing something that people do with practice, right? Doctors, nurses, physical therapists, they can bring healing to someone's body. Even spiritually, followers of Jesus can pray for someone and see God work a miracle for them. Now, forgiving sins, on the other hand, well, that's something only God can do. That's way harder than healing. And what Jesus shows us here is that, well, he can do both. He can say both because he can do both. He's the one that's capable of both physical healing and spiritual restoration. Him and him alone. Nobody else can lay a claim to that. No one else can say they can do that. Matthew's teaching us here what makes Jesus so special. Now, the one word that sums up Jesus is here at the end of the passage, and that's authority. He has the authority to do anything and everything just by who he is. The crowd wonders, like, God's given this authority to man? And they're going to learn, like, no, God gave this authority to Jesus, right? Like, it's just Jesus who's able to walk around and forgive sins. It's only because he's God that he can do that. But this is sort of a breakthrough watershed moment for Jesus' ministry here. We've known that Jesus is Emmanuel. He's God with us. But the people didn't. And now they're starting to see that. They're starting to get glimpses of it. Here's Jesus with the ability, the authority to forgive sins, and he's doing that, and he's healing people right amongst all of them. And so I think what's ultimately important about any one of us is whether or not we will yield to his authority. That is the most important thing about you. Now that we've walked through the text, there's three things I want to call attention to. The first is that we can carry other people to Jesus with our faith. Jesus says Jesus saw their faith. The men carrying their friend to Jesus are putting their faith in him to help. You don't cave in somebody's roof if you don't think Jesus can help them. If you're going to go through that much trouble, you're convinced it's for a good reason, that something's going to happen here. Like, can you imagine just getting the guy on the roof, right? I don't know if you've ever watched international soccer, but if someone gets hurt, they don't have, like, the same stretcher situation that the NFL does where, you know, they've got the cart and, like, real stretchers and things. They've got the joint that's, like, two poles and a tarp in between, like an old cartoon or something, and they'll go out and kind of roll the guy onto it, and then two guys got to grab each side, and they walk off. You know, because football, there's all kinds of downtime. Like, count tonight. Like, start a stopwatch while play begins and then ends during the Super Bowl this evening, and like, it's 12 minutes of action, give or take, in NFL. Soccer game is 90 minutes of action. They're like, we're not stopping for anything. Get them off the field. And so... So this often leads to hilarity. Like, you can go online and just Google like soccer, like stretcher fail or something, and there's a ton of them. I saw this one where these two refs are trying to pick this guy up, and they cannot figure out how to get this guy off the ground. And so finally, his teammate just gets fed up, runs over, scoops the dude up in his arms, and just runs him off the field and like drops him and then runs back on. And so I picture these guys like trying to figure out, like, okay, well, how do we get this dude on the roof? Like, and they're trying to like pivot, like they're trying to get him up there. They finally get this guy on the roof. The guy on the mat's gonna be like, dude, you just chill. Like, we don't have to do this. It's okay. Someone's like, I got an idea. I mean, what's the worst that's gonna happen? You're already paralyzed, right? And they finally get up to the roof. They're like, what now? Like, start digging. Like, what? They go through so much trouble to get this guy to Jesus. Why? Because they're convinced that Jesus is going to be able to do something. They're convinced he can help. They know if they can just get their friend to Jesus, he's going to be healed. It's worth all the effort because Jesus can make a difference. And this is why this is important for us, because I believe that we can carry people to Jesus through our prayers. We've already seen with the centurion's miracle a few weeks ago that one person's faith can contribute to someone else's miracle. He goes to Jesus and is like, my servant is sick. And Jesus says, all right, I'll come pray for him. No, you just say the word. And Jesus sees his faith and goes, all right, well, I'll heal your friend. When you pray for other people, you carry them before Jesus. You bring him before him. James writes this in chapter 5, verse 16. He says, therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. When you're in Jesus, when you're in Christ, your faith is powerful, not just for you, but for anybody else that you're praying for. That's why it's important that you pray for other people. That's why it's important that when you tell someone you're going to pray for them, you then actually pray for that person. If you ever ask me to pray for you about something and you see me pull my phone out, it's not because I'm like, I don't want to hear this, because I got to write this down. Otherwise, I'm never going to remember this. I don't know my name half the time. If we tell somebody we're going to pray for him, it's important that we follow through on that. Why? Because prayer works. And one of the best things you can do for somebody is pray for them. To bring them before the throne, to carry them to Jesus. We do that with our prayers, just as sure as these guys did it with this mat. Second thing is that the story in Matthew illuminates something about sin for us. It's that our hearts are sin factories. Calvin called them idol factories because we're constantly taking good things and making them ultimate things. We're constantly taking good things and using them wrongly. In this case, the scribes are accused of thinking evil in their hearts. They are really passionate. They want to defend the honor of God. But they're doing it wrongly because they're missing that he's right in front of them. And so instead of accepting this and going with it and worshiping out of it, they're accusing Jesus of blasphemy. And this is the part that's interesting. They haven't said anything. They've not verbalized any of this. It's not, and they said to Jesus, you're a blasphemer. It's not that. All they're doing is thinking it. And Jesus goes, why do you have so much evil in your heart? Jesus looks past what's on the surface. He's looking deeper inside. What's inside? What's in your heart? It's not just about actions. It's about what's in your heart. If the inside's rotten, it doesn't matter what's on the outside. If you've got an apple, and it looks really great on the outside, and then you cut it in half and it's full of worms, it's a bad apple, right? We can be all cleaned up on the outside and still be rotten on the inside. We can think like, well, I'm doing all the right things, so I'm good. But that's not the end goal. The end goal is heart change from the inside outward. Heart change will lead to behavior change, but it doesn't work the other way. If you do the right things for the wrong reasons, they don't count. It's about the heart. The only way to change the inside is to put your trust in Jesus. Get in the Word, get in prayer, let the Holy Spirit go to work. That's it. There's no shortcuts. There's no easy way to get there. That's what it takes. Last thing here is that Matthew focuses primarily on forgiveness. That's sort of the whole point of this story, and we've called it the forgiveness controversy. He doesn't deal too much with the paralysis except for how it relates to Jesus forgiving sins. Now, it might seem kind of strange to us that this guy comes to Jesus, he's paralyzed, and the first thing Jesus thinks is, oh, your sins are forgiven. Like, well, why is he talking about that when clearly this is the problem? Now, it was a little more understandable in their day because there were a lot of people that thought that sin and sickness were directly correlated in every instance. Honestly, there's still some denominations that think like that today. But in their time, there were all of these thinkers and scholars and teachers that were always wondering, well, how much does sin play a role in sickness and back and forth? This person's sick? Well, there must be sin in their life. At one point, Jesus is going along, they see someone who was born blind, and what does Jesus get asked? Well, who sinned, this guy or his parents, that he was born blind? And Jesus is like, neither. Biblically speaking, that's not what we see, that sin and sickness go hand in hand like that. Now, sure, there are some sins that have consequences that lead to illness. If you're addicted to tobacco, lung cancer will follow. If you, gluttony may lead to heart disease or diabetes. But those aren't examples of God's punishment for sin. That's just the natural cause and effect of the world and our bodies as God has designed them. The biblical perspective is that fundamentally, all sickness can be traced back to sin. And that when Adam and Eve sin in the fall, it introduces all sorts of disruptions to creation. One of those being illness and death. But by and large, any individual suffering anything, more often than not, it's completely unrelated to their sin. Good people suffer no less than bad people suffer. The wicked can prosper and the good can suffer. Sin doesn't always receive punishment in the here and now. So it's not completely out of the blue that he would mention it to this crowd, because they might be thinking about those things. But it is interesting that Jesus goes right to forgiveness before he goes to anything about this guy's ailment. Yeah, paralysis is bad, but Jesus has come to do a whole lot more than that. The healing that Jesus does here, it's primarily just to show that his greater mission is being accomplished, that his mission of breaking the kingdom of God through into our world, part of the evidence of that is the lame walk, the blind see, the lepers are cleansed. His primary mission is forgiveness. That's always his chief concern. That means no matter what you're going through, forgiveness is God's primary objective for you. Every single one of us have a sin problem. And I don't just mean like, well, one pet sin that we've got to work on. All of us at our core, me included, are sinful people in need of redemption. So in my situation, been battling chronic migraine for years now. It's been absolutely brutal, especially over the past couple months. Despite all of that, God doesn't look at me and see my pain as my biggest problem. It's still sin. And as long as that's there, that's his chief concern. And so that means that if I go through this pain and God uses it to work on that, to work on that sin problem, uses it to renew my mind and make me more like Jesus, it's worth it. Because that's the bigger problem. That doesn't mean it's easy. That doesn't make this easier to walk through, but it does mean that it's worth it. And so that's why, as followers of Jesus, we have an answer for suffering. It did not enter my life by accident. The God who is sovereign above everything allowed it to enter so that he could use it for his good purpose. For every single one of us, no matter where we're at, pursuing forgiveness and a right relationship with God, that's got to be priority number one. Pursuing Christ, allowing him to refine us, no matter what that looks like. And so Jesus goes to forgiveness first because that's what this guy actually needed most. As one theologian put it, forgiveness of sins closes the past and opens a new future. When we put our faith in Jesus and we lay claim to the forgiveness he offers us, just as sure as this formerly paralyzed man gets up and walks, we have a bright new future ahead of us. And that is ours only when we put our faith in him. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you that you extend this forgiveness to us if only we come to you. God, I pray that you would draw all of us to you, that you would refine us, that you would allow us to see ourselves the way you see us, that would mean seeing all of the blessings and benefits that we have in you, and also seeing our problems through your priorities, that you're working on our flesh above and beyond anything else in our lives. Lord, help us to see our pain through that lens. Lord, give us faith to trust in you, in your sovereignty. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.